transfer pricing considerations of Brexit. So principally, there are two main areas that need to be thought about when it comes to transfer pricing and Brexit. The first one is the box on the left, which is business restructurings, which arise as a direct consequence of Brexit. So what we're talking about there is supply chain and business model restructuring, which has been necessary as a result of various regulatory requirements, etc., or which may be necessary moving forwards. And the key issue that needs to be thought about from a transfer pricing perspective is whether there should be any form of one-off compensation. And if so, what tax charge, you know, what should be the level of that compensation and what should be the associated tax charge? And then the second key area to think about is in the box to the right, which is number two. So that's post-Brexit restructuring steady state transactions. So that's really starting to think about, okay, we've restructured our supply chain, or we are going to restructure our supply chain. But then following that restructuring, there'll be new transactions between related parties cross-border. So those may be for license of IP, sales of products, services, etc. And I guess, you know, these are the two main areas to think about in the context of Brexit. But the stand back comment on this is very much the transfer pricing considerations apply to any multinational group which restructures its supply chain. It just so happens in this case, we're looking at those considerations in the context of the economic circumstance presented by Brexit. I'm just going to hand over to Dan, who's going to go through a little bit more about those one and two scenarios that I talked about.
Thanks, yeah. Imran. So here we've got sort of a high level overview of a potential business restructuring or a change in a supply chain that can potentially be motivated by Brexit, but doesn't necessarily have to be. So on the left, we see a UK company selling directly to EU customers and maybe has some boots on the ground in the form of rep office representative, maybe a branch, maybe a sub providing some kinds of sales support services. But the bottom line is sales are directly made by the UK company. On the right, in a post-Brexit scenario, we see two transactions being introduced. And they are sort of in line with the consideration that Imran outlined previously, which are, well, in one is obviously the intercompany sale of products, and then the EU distributor, which is now sort of the distribution entity in the European Union, is the one responsible for making the sales to EU customers, which means that there is an intercompany sale of products between the UK company and the EU sub. And then there is the implied transfer of assets, and that potentially can take the form of transfer of contracts from the UK company to the EU sub, and it can involve other assets as well. And again, as Imran said, it's not necessarily to do with Brexit, but any change in your supply chain may and potentially does have transfer pricing and direct tax implications on a international level. Next slide, please. So when talking about the transfer pricing considerations, when we're talking about the transfer of assets or the initial transfer of assets from the UK company out to an EU company or to a company outside of the UK, basically the assets could be customer contracts, supplier contracts, licenses and authorizations, or any type of regulatory required activities. So in this situation, obviously, what the question that needs to be asked and the question that HMRC asks quite often is, well, did the UK entity receive arm's length compensation for those transferred intangible assets? And obviously, the answer is, well, if it did, what this compensation should be, what should be the tax implications, and if it didn't, was it correct? Was it correct that the transfer was at zero value? Yes or no? And that's obviously questions that could be asked by the HMRC, and they are indeed asked because we see those kind of questions popping up quite often. Imran?
Yeah, so picking up on the box to the right, number two, and the two are very much inextricably linked, but that second box is all about the new transactions which will happen after the supply chain restructuring. So those new transactions may be the license of intangibles, trademarks, patents, et cetera, know-how. provision of services, including strategic services, and then remuneration for a whole host of other potential transactions, such as distribution, services, manufacturing. And the question there is, how should those, for want of a better word, steady state? So, you know, you've done all your restructuring, now you've got these steady state transactions. How should those steady state transactions be priced? Next slide, please, Cora. Back to Dan.
Yeah, so what are the factors that we'll consider when we're actually evaluating both sort of aspects of both the business restructuring and the follow-up steady state? So we're obviously looking at the legal arrangements and what kind of rights and obligations have been confirmed to the transaction, but mostly to the entity that is outside of the UK. We're also looking at the underlying substance. So it might be the case that all you do is you transfer your invoicing function and maybe some warehousing, and it may be the case that you will have actual boots on the ground of people going out and making sales. The ongoing steady state remuneration, as well as the potential transfer of assets and an exit from the UK, may be impacted by what kind of substance you have on the ground and what kind of risks are controlled in which entity. Obviously, we're looking at the bargaining position of the related parties, and here we try to simulate an arm's length situation. So obviously, bargaining positions are a bit askew when we're talking about a multinational group. We're also looking at, and we're actually obliged at looking at, options realistically available to the parties. So what kind of options would be on the table if the parties weren't related, but obviously we're trying to simulate arm's length situation. Financing should also not be ignored. So when establishing these European operations or upgrading European operations, upscaling it, how do you finance this? How do you finance your working capital? Those are obviously very important questions to answer when trying to assess how you carry on your business through transfer pricing. Imran.
Yeah, a couple of closing comments from me. We do have some really sort of interesting comments from HMRC that have been made to certain industry bodies, and absolutely happy to sort of share those, where they've given their view as to what the direct tax consequences of Brexit should be. And by and large, their view is aligned to the fact that those consequences should be no different to those which would arise on any other supply chain restructuring. But certainly we have been in dialogue with HMRC on a number of these, on a number of business restructurings that have happened for regulatory reasons, i.e. prior to the completion of the transition period, businesses have had to do quite substantial restructuring of their European supply chains. And on many of those, based on the facts, we've got to reasonably defensible and good answers that HMRC have given a level of comfort on. So you know, a lot of the restructuring is happening and is going to happen, but it's certainly not too late to consider the transfer pricing consequences and ensure that any risks are managed.